How you doing?
Doing good, doing good.
You filming? What's your name? There you go. Mm-hmm.
If y'all can take your seats, we'll go ahead and get going. I know it's 6 o'clock. Well, thank y'all. We're going to do take two on this application. I think some of y'all we met last time, some of y'all are new faces. My name is Ethan Underwood. I'm with the Lipscomb Johnson firm. I'm working with JEH Homes on a revised site plan and development plan. This is Jim Jacobi and Thad Higgins, and they'll be able to answer technical questions. I'm here as their zoning lawyer, so I'm helping to navigate the process, and we can answer any questions that y'all have, particularly regarding that process. But just in short, some of y'all came to our last meeting. We had originally proposed a Res 6 development. Since then, Jim and Thad have been working with some other neighbors. We're able to get some other property under contract. They've come back and they have revised the plan. It's now an age-targeted Res 4 zoning category, which we're proposing. The lots with the Res 4 have to be, I guess they're still going to be an attached product. So we're still working with that. So it's designed for older folks, coming empty nesters, so that those folks will have smaller yards, but nice homes with the high value. We understand that was some of the things that were brought up in the last application, last iteration of it, was, you know, how is this going to affect property values surrounding areas? So with that, thank y'all for coming out. I'll turn it over to Jim. Let y'all describe a little bit about what your vision is, and then we'll answer any questions that you have.
My name is Jim Jacobi. I'm one of the owners of JEH Homes. And I'll give you a quick little history on us. JEH Homes, we have three owners. It's myself, a gentleman named Bill Evans, and a gentleman named George Hovis. We founded our company in 2007, right as the market was starting to downturn. And we did that purposely, to be opportunistic. And our real pedigree is actually development. And we used to develop a lot of land and lots for the big builders. And we had several projects underway, and big guys started missing takedowns, delaying takedowns, and then ultimately stopping takedowns. So we had no other option but then to form a home building company and start building ourselves out of our own investments. And one thing led to another, and bought this project, bought that project, and now we actually have a bona fide real building company. This year we're going to closing is roughly a little more than 300 houses. We're now the 10th largest builder in the Atlanta metro area, according to Metro Studies' latest ranking. We will actually sell about 375 this year. We'll carry 75 homes under contract into next year. We really pride ourselves on really having a personal touch, being able to do a lot of semi-customs, option upgrades for our buyers, and being a little bit more nimble and offering products that the nationals don't do and services that they don't provide. And one thing is that we came through this downturn. We have no bankruptcies. We have no foreclosures, no bad debt. We paid off everybody, and we've survived. We've come through the other side, and now we're trying to recoup and keep our business going. I personally live not too far away, just right down the road, actually. Our business is headquartered right off of McFarland Road. We're in Forsyth County. My kids, my wife actually used to be a teacher. They speak English. And you'll probably see me at the weekends at the baseball field at Joint Venture. You'll see me at Fowler Park playing soccer or on the football field. I've got three young children. And we live in this community, and I literally drive by Mathis Airport every day. That's the way I go to work. And so I want to build something that I'm proud of. So our original zoning application was for 88 townhouses. that are what we call, they meet the zoning definition of attached, but they're not your traditional attached townhouse where the walls are actually conjoined. They're attached with underground footing and attached with the arbor that goes in the air. And if you see if the pamphlet's in, if you've got a pamphlet, but you'll see an actual picture of how the attachment works. The homes range anywhere from 7 to 10 feet apart, depending on location and where they are in the community. Forsyth, although it is attached, we still meet follow detached guidelines. You're not allowed to have any more than 6 attached at one time. After 6 attached at one time, you have to have a minimum 20 feet separation between the next building starts. And so so that helps break it up. So what we've done is we've talked a lot with a lot of surrounding neighbors. We have listened, we've modified our site plan once, and actually just recently modified our site plan again. And the latest modification reduces it down to 65 homes. We're down 3.09 units to the acre. We have decreased our fencing by 40% from our first plan. Our houses are, the product we're offering is buyer driven. It is 3-bedroom, 2.5-bath ranch houses, 2,000 square feet on the first floor. And what we do is we modify every elevation. You can build the exact same plan right next to each other all the way down the street, and you'll never notice the exact same floor plan inside the house. There's a distinct difference between each plan. We also have, we provide an optional, if somebody would like it, you can finish out a second floor. The second floor does not change the roof structure of the house. It basically just runs the joist. It provides you a loft, an in-house office, and an extra bedroom and bathroom if you'd like to have it, which is great for a teen retreat. It's usually what it can become. So our product is really buyer-driven. Extremely rarely, there are only a handful of times that a family bought this type of house that we offered. We offer, in our packet, we have the three home plans that we plan to build here. And we actually have these plans built in a community very close by called Cottages of Greystone. At Cottages of Greystone, when we first developed these plans, we needed to prototype them. And so what we did, we actually replatted the subdivision, combined 8 lots and 5 lots, and went out and prototyped these 4 plans next to each other so we can see how it worked and work out the kinks in them. So what you see for these 15 lots, this is exactly what we're proposing. If you'd like, I'll be more than happy to meet you out there one day. I can take you. I'll show you the product. You can walk all the way around it. You can walk in and you can experience it. Kind of the white elephant in the room, yes, there's a cemetery on the property. If you've seen the news, I'm sure you've heard all about it. We have, and I'll tell you an interesting story how that kind of came about. I was actually talking to one of the nearby neighbors. And they told me, hey, did you know there's a cemetery in the property? And I thought, well, no, I did not know that. And started investigating it a little bit more and actually went back to my office and opened up Google Earth, took the Google Earth timeline bar and slid it all the way back and looked at the exact area where this person circled where it would be. And sure enough, there was something showing on Google Earth. It wasn't exactly explicit what it is, but you could tell something was there. So it's enough to kind of raise a red flag for us. We investigated it further, and I actually included the information in that packet. It's called the England Family Cemetery. And that packet gives you the dates, who's buried there, and what is there. We engaged probably the best archaeological group in the state of Georgia called New South Associates. They went out, did their studies, and they determined, yes, there are 9 graves there. Most likely a 10th. They said, if there is a 10th, it's going to be a child because it was small. We located it, we picked up, we went back, field located everything that they discovered. We put it on the site plan. We have worked around it. And most importantly, we're going to restore this cemetery. As you know, the gravestone's not even there. It's completely paved over, desecrated. And if much more time goes on, you know, probably would have gotten forgotten about. And so what our ambition is to welcome the cemetery, restore it, preserve it, and make it an asset in the community. And honestly, we would like to get a historical mark and describe what it is if it was there. And we have another community that we have done a cemetery in as well. It actually dated back to 1785 or 1765. And we worked around it, we incorporated it into our design, and worked very well with the Forsyth County Historical Society with that one. Let's see, a couple of the features of the community is you're coming up the hill, we're gonna have a little small cemetery. And what we did is we were asked to try and make our design as aesthetic as we can. And so we started including a lot of pocket parks. So you'll notice a lot of pocket parks and vistas, and also include additional parking within our community. So as you come up this hill, your eye will focus through the cemetery, and as you come around, your eye will focus in this pocket park. In this pocket park, we're gonna have a mail kiosk, which serves as a central mail kiosk for our entire community. And if the postmaster allows, and if the residents on Mathis Airport Road will allow us, we'll actually have this mail kiosk be the mail kiosk for the entire area. And so what we propose is a sidewalk that can connect to a parking pad here so that you can walk around it, and then you can come right back in if you prefer that. So as you come in, you have the central park here, and as you come down this street, we have another little small gathering park with additional parking. And then what we did is we broke up our buildings so that we created much more interest with our landscape. And we really want to develop a very nice community. We really believe that this will be this community will start in the 270s price point for about 2,000 or 2,600 square feet. So what we've done is we have Forsyth County Sewer. Right here in the right of way, and our intention is to connect to the sewer that's in the right of way. We have our detention pond here at this site, and one big feature that we're going to have in this, which I think will be really unique, and will actually further attract the buyers that we're really going after, is we're going to provide a community garden. And it's our intent to have this community garden not just available to our residents only, but anybody that would like to be, anybody that lives along Mathis Airpark that would like to come participate in the community garden, and really make this entire park a future and useful space for the whole airport subject. That's roughly about it. Now this, we've decreased our density. Now, I know there's a lot of people around that would love to have $1 million houses on this site, and that's just not economically feasible for us. I believe we've offered a great product that will mitigate traffic concerns, and will also definitely mitigate the impact on schools. I am sensitive to that myself, but it's small children. And so that was our targeted focus. One thing we really want to do is bring something different to the market. There's an enormous amount of Res 3 zonings coming up all over this, let's say zonings. There are no new developments. They're already in the works, already in progress. Zonings that we've done a long time ago. And what we're seeing, we track, we actually have our own in-house strategic marketing firm. And we track lots, what's called VDLs, vacant developed lots, and the coming supplies. And we're actually seeing what we call the bubble in the hose. And we're really concerned that there's gonna be too many builders gonna be building too much of the same thing. And we're trying to offer something different. And most importantly, we're trying to go after a niche buyer. At this point, our only real competition is going to be the orchards. The orchard just got a new zone off of Highway 141. They were approved for 4.5 units to the acre, which is actually at 141 and Stony Point Road. So we're only requesting, and their product is all attached. Our product, you're actually going to be detached. You'll see through each individual unit. We are, that's really about it. I'll be happy to open the floor if there's any questions anything I can help you with. Yes, sir.
Can you explain to me a little bit more about the age restriction type? Because I know earlier, the last meeting, one of my concerns were the overcrowding of the schools. Mm-hmm. And so I understand you're moving to age restriction. Can you discuss that a little bit more for us?
Yes, sir. Well, we are what's going to call a lifestyle targeted community. We don't want to have it truly as an age restricted community. It's going to be age targeted, lifestyle targeted, meaning downsizing, or single B. And that's really the buyers that we're trying to go after. That's really going to be our targeted audience are those buyers.
Okay. Because I was over at, I can't remember all the names of the subdivisions, but I went into one subdivision, and there's a large section of it that's age restricted. I think it's 55 and above. And I can understand that this works great for these people because they do not have, some of them are scared about the kids running down the street or they just don't want to hear the noise of them. So I just know that was pretty good. And one of my major complaints last time was that this was going to create too many school age children for the southern end of the county.
And we listened, and that's exactly what we did. We came up with this policy. If you think about it, there's not another all ranch house community. I mean, that's a new home community. There's not another new home community that's offering all ranch homes. So this will be the only one, so it really feels a void and a niche in the market for us. And like I said, you know, myself and my little company, I can't play in the same sandbox as the Rylands and the Nars and the D.R. Horton of the world. These have too much money, too much power, and they fight with brass knuckles. And you know, at the end of the day, they're Wall Street driven, revenue driven, and you know, I've got to make a little bit of money because I've got employees and you know, expenses. If we lose money, it comes out of the wall. And so we've got to be very sensitive as to what we build and really try to focus on having a successful community. Yes, sir.
Can you help me understand why attached housing is more profitable than unattached housing? As a former builder, I just want to throw that out there and see if you can answer that question.
So what's your question again?
You have attached houses in that subdivision, yes?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you explain to me why that is more beneficial? Forget the niche of your marketing aspect. Can you tell me why you can't make money in attached housing? I know there are a couple other builders who can. I'm just trying to figure out why you can't.
We do make money in attached housing.
Okay, so what's the reluctance of having detached housing?
Well, that's what we're doing. Ours are theoretically detached. And they're sitting anywhere between 7 to 10
theoretically
feet.
Or really? It's a quasi-detached product. It has to have like an arbor that attaches them, but that's what's going to be connected.
Do they share a wall?
No. If you see the picture.
Does it look like they share a wall, might I say?
Mm-hmm. So you have the picture? You have the picture of the pamphlet? No, inside the pamphlet, you have a picture of the product?
No, the only one I saw was on the website from the county.
We'll get you one, but this is, on the county, this is what's on the site plan. And this is the same home.
So no shared walls between any of these products?
Well, if you look on this picture in the center,
this is the spot between each house.
Okay. So the original one that I thought I saw, and I must be mistaken, was that they were shared. They had a shared wall between some of them.
Yes, it looks like this between each house. And then every, at maximum 6 units, we maximum do us at 20 feet between. We actually have varying buildings.
And the side setbacks, you asked for those to be reduced?
No, sir, not the side setbacks, our front setbacks.
Front setbacks.
And what that does, it enables us to pull our houses closer to the road and away from the surrounding property owners. And it still enables the plus or minus 25 feet that you need for park a car.
They're all front entry?
Yes, sir.
What do the back of the houses look like? Just curious.
That's a good question. Back of the houses.
Can everybody hear? I know we're getting kind of side conversations, so I want to make sure everybody's getting the same
thing. I just asked a question. What do the backs look like, considering I'm stuck with a long view of it?
We're going to show you all an example. Abutting our zoning is another zoning, which is the last phase of Agnew. And its density was 3.09 units per acre as well. And we're going to show you.
You said that abuts to you?
Yes, sir. I mean, it's right there.
You mean over there where you put the garden, right?
This is where you put the garden at.
Right. This driveway right here.
There's nothing to butt up to your houses, right?
Correct.
Exactly.
That's supposed to be properties, right?
The boundary.
But what also abuts to your property is 16 acres of raw land.
With streams and a lake.
With a lake and a stream, the big field. But also abuts to it, so I mean, I was just, okay, all right.
So what we were asked to do was to avoid this look. And this is the look if you're looking down Mathis Airport. It's from the front of the houses, it's a pretty house. And so our houses, they're one story, and that's it. Even if we build the second story, there's not an expansion in here. It doesn't stay, so you only see one story. Basically, it wraps around. I wish I had a picture of the rear of the home.
So what's the rear of the home made of? That's what my ask is.
I mean,
Siding. And how far, and what's your setback?
Setback.
And you're on the rear, setback.
There's a 50-foot exterior setback.
Right, we have a 50-foot exterior setback, and what we've done is we put in a 25-foot buffer that goes around the property. So, and our intent is, we do not want to get in that buffer only in the worst-case scenario if we have to. Most importantly, what I want to do is enhance the buffer. And that's a great question, too. What we've also done is we have planted and are proposing to put in a large evergreen buffer here. Of Leland cypresses. And so eventually those Leland cypresses will just have a wall.
How about the rest of it?
On the rest of it,
yeah.
What we've got coming down from here, as you can see how the open space gets much wider and wider as it keeps going around. And so our intent is to try to preserve as much of those trees and natural vegetation as possible. And where we can, we will replant and embellish it. Now there's a large open area through here. Yes. I don't know if you can see, but right through here. And this area, there are some views that you can come back through this way. And so we want to block that off. We want to screen it, enhance it, and embellish it. There's a good bit of pine trees that are starting to come up through here. They're getting 15 feet, maybe 18 feet tall. And with time, they're going to get bigger and bigger. But we want to really screen it and make it even a thicker screen. So that's, and most importantly, when we develop a subdivision, we were going to have to do tree recommends. The county and you divide your acreage, big trees you're taking out, and you have to replace those trees. And so, usually, the tree recommends is so, there's so many trees coming on there that your buffers are really planted very well. Just the way the county's calculations are.
Yeah, we've been in the county a long time, but I don't really know what's that.
Yeah, they do. Absolutely. I mean, we the arborist, correct? The arborist, the new arborist, he will follow me tooth and nail. And great guy, like him a lot. But just do what you say, and everything works out. And so we will actually present in our LDP set. We will present a landscape plan, and the landscape plan will have a tree replacement plan. And the tree replacement plan will call out every single tree where it's going to be placed.
Might be off topic, but is there any kind of fencing going up between your property and the adjacent properties?
We can. If you'd like some fencing, we can put some fencing. We're open to that.
I think the gentleman in the black coat before we move on. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I just was curious. What's the largest home your company builds today?
Our largest house is probably 43, maybe around 4,000 square feet. Okay.
Because I've lived in this area for a number of years, and it seems like everybody is competing at the sub $400,000 home level, and there isn't really much. I know you mentioned, kind of finding your niche in this area where, most of the other builders aren't, and it seems to be that $400,000 to $600,000 area seems to be an area of opportunity that would, I'm not exactly sure what all your topography and other challenges of putting larger homes. I'm scratching my head a little bit with kind of your strategy in terms of what you're offering, but although it's, you're marketing towards people of a certain age, the reality is we're going to have people with kids and starting season week starter homes. People will be moving in, and it will be impacting the schools. You can't stop that. You can't control that. You can market it all, and I know this has happened in other communities around here that have been more retirement type focused. The reality is just you can't say no. It's against the law, right? To tell somebody you can't buy the house if they're of a certain age.
Unless it's deed-restricted to 55.
What I would love to do is maybe if I got you.
You have
I've heard that from other people. I've heard that same exact concern from other folks. And so what I did is I went and showed them the house we're going to build. And they walked it and experienced it. And I said, you're right. This really is not conducive to a family. And it's not designed. It's not intended. four families. And so if I could get you out to the houses and you could walk and experience the house, and then you'll say, Jim's got a point. I mean, these plans are targeted specifically for a certain buyer.
Why not restrict the deed then?
Yeah, restrict the deed. And if you're doing the older, why do we have a pool and a cabana and playfield and?
It's no longer a playfield. It's going to be a park, and it's going to be a park for the greater area. There's other children that live back here on this road. And I think if we could enhance this park and have provide a place for the other children to play as well. And then I lost my train of thought there. The swimming pool. We actually did a study and analysis, and actually said the active adults of those inside the market we're trying to capture, they actually do want to live here, and they want a place to swim. Not necessarily for themselves, but when the grandchildren come over to play, they want a place to recreate. And so that's what we do.
So again, back to the deed restricting the land to only be sold to people age 55 and older. Are you willing to do that?
No, sir.
Why not?
Because I don't think I would get my financing. It's still, for private builders like us, I mean, we've done well. A lot of the bankers are still wounded and licking their wounds. And unfortunately, I'm not made of cash. I'm not doing all this out of my pocket.
Sure.
I've got to go to the banks, and I've got to get a loan, and deed restriction will actually impair my ability to get the loan.
So you've not acquired the property yet?
No, sir. I have the property under contract. And what we're proposing is this site. And one other thing I'd like to include, it actually was in a packet that was in your information. This airport, which is the owner of this airport, is going through bankruptcy. He's filed for bankruptcy. So everything is in the bankruptcy court. Anything that's done, any sort of contract negotiation, it's just not up to this one guy and myself to do. Everything has got to go through the proper channels and get approved in those the judicial procedure. This airport, when he bought the airport, the airport was originally has a designation to FAA as a public-private designation, which means that anybody that's flying over who needs gas can come in and get gas. It also means it was available to the public to come in and just use the airport. What he did was he closed the airport. He made it a membership-only airport. There's 33 members in this airport. And one article you'll see in that, in the pamphlet I gave you of information, it actually discussed, I think there were 5 crashes in the span of 2 years. And I remember living in a county where there was just repeated instances at this airport. And then the airport is kind of the buzz when the airport is tied down because this guy bought it and closed it off to all the traffic. And so what we're trying to do is take the airport off the market. We're trying to recoup and revitalize, restore the cemetery. And this is just a unique parcel of land. It's not a parcel of land that's going to be conducive to 400,000, 500,000, 600,000 other houses. It's just simply not. If you had a $500,000 house, would you want to have a road in the back door like this?
I have a road in my backyard like that.
Have you driven down this road before?
Well, no, I haven't.
See, it's just this piece of land is not conducive to that. And so, and that's what it is a very unique property. If it was a great property where we had a graystone, there was a big lake and there was a rolling pasture tree. Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned that road, we call it the ring road that goes around. How much of that road does the airport claim down to the center of the road? To the whole full cross? I'd like to know.
That's a good point. And when we buy this, assuming the zoning goes through, and assuming we close on the property, right now there's a big, one big issue on this road is maintenance of this private road. And in fact, this was actually the center of a litigation that went on for 10 or 12 years, back and forth. It seemed like never ended from what I had told. When we buy this and acquire this property, we will actually own 42% of the road.
Of that road around, how do you figure that? Do you mean to the center? All the way across?
Of the asphalt area, we will own, we have calculated the amount of asphalt area of the road. From the beginning of the road to the very end of the road, we've calculated the area of the asphalt. We will actually, our homeowners association will own.
See, I'm trying to figure that out. I want to understand how. Because there was a settlement that everybody had property joined to the properties that are along that road that went to the center. Are you saying that fully across? Can you buy this?
The consent order, we own to the center line of the road. And then so like, for example, in this area, we own the entirety of the road. In this area, we own half of it.
That's what I was trying to get to. That's what I was
saying. So for example, this area, we own half of the asphalt.
And for your information, the county's the one that destroyed that road. When they built the four lane of Mathis, they used that airport to misuse that road and took big trucks to destroy that road. And the property owner should have went to the county soon.
Well, the good news is that our homeowner association will own 42% of the road. So now, a big cost of repairing the road is taken off of the embattled parties up and down the road, and we're going to take it over.
So you would pay the right off, is that what you're saying?
So it would be a nice looking road for other homes to look onto then, right?
You'd have to drive it and make that decision yourself. What I'm most importantly what I'm saying is that the road is in, yeah, it's in a state of disrepair. And the big contention is the cost of redoing. And we will cover 42% of the maintenance cost. We will cover our program share of the road.
But in addition, also do note that the access drive is actually going to be going off to the north and not to the south.
And so what's the width of that road going to be?
It'll have to be a minimum. You got a 50-foot right-of-way to meet county requirements, and you have to have at least 20 feet of asphalt.
What's the percentage of usage subdivision would have on the road relative to the people that are already using it?
Well, I mean, looking at this point, I think it'd just be from here to here, mostly. Right. There's no reason for folks to go back here, maybe a crossing here to the and that would probably be a pedestrian crossing.
Right. We just have a pedestrian crossing connecting the two communities. We purposely separated them. We wanted to mitigate as much traffic as we can going back on the road. And so what we did is there's a county public right-of-way that comes off of Mathis Airport. It comes up to this point and then turns into here. So what we're going to do is we're going to expand the right-of-way and bring the right-of-way all of it into our property. And so it'll be a county road throughout the project.
50-foot.
Yes, 50-foot right-of-way, which but you only had 20 feet of pavement, and you had utilities on the side.
Where's y'all entrance? You got an entrance?
I'm sorry?
Y'all got an entrance somewhere on that road? Or like you got a big sign showing it's your subdivision? An entrance?
You want a subdivision sign?
Are y'all going to have one? That's
we'll
what
I'm asking. Sure, we'll have an entrance monument in this area.
Monument?
Mm-hmm. I'm coming in late to the meeting. The ramps that you have down below, that's what they're going to look like?
Yes, ma'am.
What, how many bedrooms, how big is it?
It's three bedrooms, 2.5 baths on the first floor. It's 2,000 square feet on one level. Mm-hmm. And the plans are designed and intended solely for lifestyle models. Really designed for single people and designed for the active adults and the family. And that's our target. No, ma'am, this is completely different problem.
Because I know in those townhomes, there's a ton of rents. Like, the real estate agent, my husband and I went in to take a look at it just to see what they look like. The woman said literally they have a list of people that are willing to rent. If you buy the property, they will find you a renter immediately. This seems like, yeah, it was JEH Homes. Kind of that James Creek area. And this would definitely bring families in for the sake of the schools. Mm-hmm. And obviously, as the gentleman back there had mentioned, our schools are jammed as it is. And this would be a perfect segue for somebody to get in here and be able to get their kids in school and just rent a home. And can we restrict that?
The way this neighborhood is currently set up without it being deed restricted, is this a perfect neighborhood for the Walmart worker?
Yeah.
They'll be able to afford the rent, and they'll be able to afford it with their salaries.
Rental houses, investor houses, are not 270s price.
Sure.
In this area, they are.
In this area, they are.
You're telling me that a manager at Walmart can't rent
If it were all renters, you know, everybody in here was a renter. The HOA is going to maintain all the landscapes and will have rights to maintain all the exteriors. So what our intention is to make sure this community does not degrade over time. And so, this morning.
Can you put a percentage into your covenants restricting how many rental properties you need in the community?
We definitely do. That's exactly right. We do that. And actually, if we want to, we can limit this one. Yes. What would you like?
Can you explain, you mentioned earlier that land is not conducive to $400,000 to $600,000 homes, and when I look at it, it seems that if you widen these lots, it would be very conducive to that, and in fact, I live in an approximately $400,000 home nearby, and I would be very thrilled to own property in that beautiful land for $400,000. So I think the notion that you can't make money with a $400,000 to $600,000 product is misguided in the area and the demographic of South Forsyth County.
We must also consider that there's, you know, we have lakeside farms, we have rural springs, or picking up one anywhere nearby, and I want to go head to head with their price point. This tract of land does not offer the opportunity to provide that type of look and feel. Just doesn't.
Well, but the homes have appreciated in those communities well beyond the $500,000 to $600,000. There's nothing new in this area between $400,000 and $600,000. Everybody is slugging it out in the $200,000 to $400,000, and coming to the county with your high density, you know, rezoning, you know, plans to build these communities, and it's killing our schools. And with all due respect to the attorney over here, you're representing a lot of these builders and developers.
Yeah,
and
right.
You are sowing the seeds to ruin the quality of life that we all enjoy in this part of the county.
You know, interestingly, everybody said that when we zoned your property. They said, we don't want those people here. But what I've found is that when folks like y'all move into the county, our education system improved, our park system improved. Nobody likes change.
But what
we found is that when people come in and they invest in their community and they're good, interested citizens, it's made it. This was the poorest county in the state of Georgia 50 years ago, maybe as close as 30 years ago.
But there was nothing here. There was nothing here. Now we're sensitive.
My kids go to school here, and that's what keeps property values. Good school systems, good parks, that's what keeps property values. We get that. And that's why Jim's actually coming in here with density lower than what's in the surrounding communities. He's coming in with a product that's going to be marketed to folks
What surrounding communities are you talking about?
For example, Abington.
We're being selective about that. Yeah. The average around the area is not lower.
No. We've also been sensitive to the number of foreclosures. We talk about the houses in the 400 to 600. There have been a numerous amount of foreclosures.
Trust me, many of us want to get rid of the airport. No, I don't think you're going to find anyone arguing against getting rid of
it. No, I like the airport. I like the airport.
All right, one person. So, but, you know, let's be sensible about this. And, you know, the fact that you're not willing to restrict the deed of the property tells me that, you know, you don't want to make it difficult to sell these homes. I can't believe that if it's such an attractive segment to market your homes after, why a bank wouldn't be willing to fund the project.
You got to figure that we're also cutting out an enormous segment of the our buyer population to do that too. It's not families. That's not the targeted buyer. It is the seniors. Person is also a big segment of my buyers. And I don't mean a single 20-something from Buckhead coming up to Forsyth County and here's the party. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a married couple. They've now decided they don't want to long live together. One parent doesn't want to be far away from the other family. They want to still stay in the community. And this is a prime product for them. And what I'd like for you to do, I'll be more than happy to meet each and every one of you individually in our houses, walk the houses. We can talk to it and see the product. But this, the crossroads, I strongly believe this property is, and we can just agree to disagree, this property is not conducive to the $400,000 to $600,000 price point. And most importantly, I believe this product that we're offering is going
can
to
you explain
is going is the, hold on, let me finish. This product we're offering is definitely gonna let's say it was 200, let's just say it was 2.5 units of the acre. If I got 2.5 units of the acre and he's thinking I'm building big houses and big stuff, that's actually gonna hurt the schools more so than what this is.
But can you explain, you keep saying it's not conducive, why? Why is it not conducive?
Some of it just doesn't offer the character and the charm that competing communities do. I mean, I've got the North, a beautiful community right next to the school on the road. I've got Ryland down the road. I've got D.R. Horton right down the road. I can't.
One thing it offers is
some of it's priced a lot, sir.
When I was looking for houses in South Forsyth, I was trying to find one that I could have a flat lot and play with my kids in the yard. Okay. That is a rarity, which I have.
I don't want you to buy a subdivision. I don't want you to buy here. That's my point. I don't want you to want a flat yard so you can play with the kids. I don't want that. I want small, tiny yards.
But if you have fewer houses, that takes care of the
But you keep saying that. That's always the answer. Fewer houses, bigger houses, richer people. That's what we always hear. But the issue you got is these roads, irrespective of how many houses, you got the same amount of asphalt, you got the same amount of wire, you got the same amount of cable, you got to be in there. And there's a cost that hits. And you, at some point, you have to have enough volume to be able to pay for that and be able to make a profit. And it's easy to say, I would love to have five houses.
And also,
but it's just not feasible.
I'm not interested in doing $400,000 to $600,000 houses. I don't believe I'll be able to compete. I know.
There's nobody selling that price point. You keep mentioning the same builders that are building sub 300,000s of.
Go to North Side Brand New Subdivision, James Burgess Road, from the 400 to the $400,000 to $500,000 price point.
Cheswick, right off of Majors Road, they're in phase two
and
three.
JEH Homes is coming right down all the land. I got Deal Horton coming right down all the land. I got Deal Horton. I got Deal
Horton is not building about 400,000.
Cheswick,
yeah.
Cheswick is.
I'm going to be selfish on my questions right here, but I want to go through a few things that you said. I just want me to. Okay, A, you know, you're talking about a little garden right there for everybody that lives on the airport road. Well, A, they're probably not going to need them because all those are a state home sitting on 2+ acres. So, I mean, you know, you're not building it for those people. I mean, just trust me, that just assume you not have that there and not have to overlook that. So, I mean, that I don't really understand your grasp on that. Two, you're saying the layout of that right there isn't conducive for big houses. Well, you got Luberon, it's right across the street from me. This got one road down one side. All the houses are on one side, looking back the other way. Well, I don't know about you, but I think that the view from the top of that mountain is a whole lot better than what Luberon has.
Yeah.
So, A, that right there really don't. The whole key is this is your niche and this is where you make your money. That's why you want to do it, and I understand that, and I respect that as a builder myself. All right, but my questions are,
which question? Luberon.
Yeah, but Luberon's coming back. They just sold another house.
Correct.
Everybody went bankrupt back then. Very few of us builders did. I didn't either. And I'm still building and I'm stronger now than I was. But I'm a builder, so I know where you're coming. The reason you want to build this is your niche, this is where you make your money. It's not, I do bigger houses, I do smaller houses. This is what you do, so this is what you're trying to shoehorn in here. All right, my concerns, and I'm hoping that you've probably heard them from the past, is Forsyth County doesn't really care about anything that goes on, period, about the pond that you back up to. They keep dumping water into it, it keeps flooding, and, you know, dirt and dirt and dirt. My goal, my fear is you're putting all these houses up there, and, you know, you don't care what the back of the house looks like, but, you know, you're sitting on a piece of property that everybody drives up and down back of the road is going to see this whole piece of back of the property. I don't care if it's one story. You keep saying that, but it's only going to be one story. People aren't going to see it. You know, it's going to be, well, I see it every day because I own the 16 acres right next to you. So, you know, you're talking about you back up to this other subdivision is 3.9. Now, I guarantee you more of your houses back up to my property, and I got 16 acres. I'm not zoning that. I don't really want to look at it. That's where I'm going to be a little You started off meeting says that you spoke with all the neighbors surrounding you. I've never heard from
all of them. I said I spoke with some of the neighbors.
Okay. Well, you didn't speak with me, and I think I got your longest property line of anybody.
Okay. Well, what I did is I spoke with some of the neighbors back here, and the concern was, you know, what are we going to see leaving our house every day? What are we going to be looking at driving down our road?
Right. And that's my question. What am I going to see leaving my house every day? I'm going to see a bunch of houses side by side with siding on the back.
You're actually going to see evergreen screen and big box. And actually, the majority of your property is heavily forested.
No, it's so not.
It's right here. You can see it.
No, that's not the majority of my property.
There's a line right here that's open. It's open. I've already acknowledged that.
Oh, yeah.
It's open.
But
this right here, this whole entire line going back this way.
Yeah, that side.
And this side coming down here, it's old. It's old forest. It's big trees. But I don't want to impact you. Well, I will work with you, and I will give you every bit of evergreen screen that you like.
My main thing is I know which way water drains, and you know your storm sewer that you're running way down here, that only catches the street. It doesn't catch the runoff of the houses that hit the grass to go straight into the pond.
Well, that's all a good point, too, because actually what we got to do, and actually, we were actually very sensitive to your lake when we designed the subdivision. Actually, my background is land planning engineer.
Okay.
So, and I knew, you know, your lake was going to be a sensitive topic. I did not know you, never talked before, but I knew that the lake would be a top topic. And so what we did is, and you're right, we purposely designed our detention pond and our water to come back this way. But what we can have is we will have drop-ins in the back of the yards that will catch all the water from the back of the yards and bring it this way. I want to mitigate, nothing to make me happy to not have one drop of water from this side of the pond. And I don't want any liabilities to be associated with it. And that's why I'm really motivated to have as big of a buffer as I can through that area.
And that's why a fence, because I can't take liability of drownage.
I agree. I'll do a fence too.
Starting off by saying that you back up, I mean, that right there, wrong foot would be, you don't, most of your, I think zero of your homes actually back up to another subdivision that's sitting on less than 1 acre. I mean, I might be wrong. I mean, you did the counts. Does any house you have butt up against a neighborhood that is sitting on a house with less than 1 acre?
We do not have a house that butts up. We do not have a house that butts up.
Right. I mean, every house you have backs up to a home sitting on, I'm going to say, a minimum of 2 acres.
Okay.
So, that's what I don't understand how Forsyth County is, you know, allowing it, because I don't believe it's even zoned that way, is it?
No. And the zoning future land use map, or proposed, calls for suburban living. Personally, I think it should have been to stay residential, but I wasn't involved in that. Because you're taking this bowl of your high-density development and setting it in the middle of a state residential. The land use map says suburban living, which is Res 2, Res 3. But more importantly, it says that it should be similar to the surrounding area, to be an asset to that area. And this should be in a village living district that's planned. You know, I mean, this is apples and oranges. You're setting this right in the center of something where people have invested, and you talked about making money, and I own a business, I want to make money too. I feel like you might think you're getting beat up. I just want to say that. Nobody's wanting you not to make money. But with that said, Dennis has his investment there too, of an estate home lot. Many of the other people surrounding it have invested and want to make money, as just like you do, off of their investments as well. When you come in and you sit in the middle of an estate community, completely surrounding it, and you're doing a multifamily village type of a situation, is apples and oranges. It will hurt their investment and hurt their profit.
And really help you.
Yeah.
And finish our schools.
Right. I mean, those homes overlooking my field and the pond is going to bump your price up, but it's going to sink my price.
Correct.
Yeah. And I don't care how pretty it is, how beautiful it is, how manicured the lawns are, it will. I mean, you know.
We've had several, we've had numerous communities, we've had neighbors who've said the same thing. And in reality, the worst case scenario that you're describing did not happen. And
can you provide us with data with that?
If you do just a quick, since you're into statistics, if you do statistics, and let's say it's in a suburban living, that's 2.5 of those 2 acres. That gives you 52 houses on this track. So if you say 52 houses, I'm not gonna build this, I'm gonna build a 5-bedroom house on every single block. Minimum 5-bedroom, if not a 6-bedroom. I'm gonna put as much square footage as I can in blocks. Which then means I'm gonna have not only a family, I'm gonna have teenagers, and most likely, they're gonna have some grandchildren that they're gonna have to see. So if you do that, that's 260 bedrooms that's coming right here. And you may say, density, I got 260 bedrooms. This one right here, if I got 65 houses, and I do it times 3.5 bedrooms, because I got 3 bedrooms and I have a 4th bedroom option upstairs. So I'm going to split the difference there. I have 3.5. Half of them going to be 3, half of them going to be 4. I got 227 bedrooms. The most important, most of those bedrooms are empty, because it's going to be an active buyer. They're not going to have children. That's the buyer I'm after. I've mitigated traffic, because now I don't have teenagers driving on the road. I don't have grandparents driving on the road. And truthfully, let's face it, if I go build that product, there's one demographic that's going to swarm to me. And
I disagree. I got five bedrooms in my house, and I got 3 people that live there.
I can take you every new home builder.
I just got to say,
school district.
But
I can take every
home builder.
But also, it's a perfect property for an investor. Yeah, it's a perfect price point. You buy it for $200,000.
I'll do 0% rents. That makes you happy. No investors. I'll put in the covenants 0% rents. It takes no investors. I'll do 0% rentals. The HOA documents will have all landscapes included, and it'll have that the HOA has the right to come onto your property and fix anything that's broken if you don't fix it. You know, build your own equipment. I'll do that. That's how much I believe in this community. But if I do age restricted, it completely takes out my divorce buyer. And it's a big segment in this market right now. And that's a segment that the Rylands at 400,000, and the D.R. Hortons in the high threes, and the 500,000, they can't offer it to that buyer. And that's the one major demographic I'm trying to go to. I'm trying to mitigate the streets. I'm trying to mitigate the traffic. I drive in front of this subdivision most days to work. I live
right here. You know how dangerous that interest coming out.
That intersection's got plenty of visibility. I've driven that intersection numerous times, up and down. How many times I've been in an intersection now, walking this property? I've been there. I'm on a 4-lane parkway. I'm not on a 2-lane road. Most importantly, I don't have a conflicting traffic coming out this way. It's a dead end. And I've already got all the infrastructure is already in place. We're not waiting on infrastructure. I'm not coming out on the Stony Point Road. I'm not coming out on the Bagley Road. With this, I'm not coming out on 2-lane lanes, a 4-lane parkway.
The people are flying up. They're speeding over.
Engineers have developed this curb cut was here before the parkway. The engineers designed this thing with adequate sight distance both ways.
No, it was not. They said if you can't keep the traffic, are you an engineer? Are you?
Yeah, I'm certified.
Let me ask you something. I've done land planning engineering for six years in my career. We understand the concern. This is the best road in the county. Short of 400, this is the best road. It doesn't get any better.
No, it ain't worth the crap. Because I live there and I know.
They don't get any better.
Oh, it does get better. If they would took down the elevation on the roads, it would have been better. But they didn't spend the money properly.
You live here?
Yes, I do live here.
Where do you live?
I live in that rental house whenever I please. I live in my shop whenever I please. On the land that joins across the road. And I've lived there all my life. I've never left this county.
You're actually your home side residence is actually on the boat.
So what? I can be in any home I want to live in.
You just said you live here, but you don't.
I do live here.
Ma'am, let's not argue. I don't think we're going to change minds.
You said earlier that the cottages are going to be this similar.
Yeah, why don't you tell the truth about why you're stuck in the park up here?
If we're going to do this,
from the
It would just make sense to break up and let's all talk separately. If there's questions and information that the community needs, let's talk about it, but it's not constructive. Ma'am?
Okay, so earlier you said that the cottages off of 141, those are ranches?
What we did is we prototyped five of them. We had some, that community is predominantly our smaller cottage product.
Is it going to be similar to what you're proposing here?
Only five of the houses. I'd have to go show you the specific five ranches and exactly how it works.
My question for that community is what percentage of that community is seniors versus family, the divorced type person?
Out of five of those units, we had two were single ladies that bought, two were active adults, we had one that was a young family, just had a young baby, another moving out. Out of five, we had one out of five was a family, so to speak. So it was 20.
How many units are on that over there? It's
zone 4 units to the acre, is what it's zoned. And actually, truthfully, what I'm trying to do is, you may know of a project at the other side of Laurel Springs. Right outside the main entrance gate of Laurel Springs is a project called the Villas at Laurel Springs. And in that project, even in the depths of the economy, and it was so bad, they still sold houses. It's not age restricted. They still sold houses and they still made it work. And if you go look at what the price point they're selling at, that's where I'm comparable. That's my competition. That's where I'm competing. But that's what I'm trying to replicate and replace. There's not another one of those projects around. The only other thing that is going to be remotely like it, let's hypothetically, in the zoning, if it gets approved, the only thing that would be like this would be the orchards, but they're all 100% truly condemned and attached.
Are you planning on marketing? Because I think, I'm not necessarily happy about, but it's just is what it is, but are you marketing towards that age group? Because I think that is a sector, with the aging population, that is a sector I think that is missed. And I think I was in real estate and before that, when my parents were looking, I think that information is not being given to people that there's a huge tax break here for, the elderly. And I think that, it's necessary to, if that's what you're, marketing towards, that information has to be out there. And it never, and I'm not, of course, speaking of you, your company, but I think that information wasn't out there before, that wasn't given to the communities or to the people that are looking in the communities. And I think if that's your sector, which would make me very happy, because I do have kids in the school as well, but I think that information has to be so relevant, because there's no reason to go to North Falling, or there's no reason to go anywhere with the kind of tax break that Forsyth County has for 65 and older. So are you planning on really marketing that?
That is the buyer we want. That's the buyer we're going after, that's the buyer we want. That's what this product is designed for. And I believe that is our best, biggest niche right now in the South or South America.
Keep mentioning divorced families. I'm not picking on them, but again, if that's your target and that's what you're going after, then back it up with the restricted deed.
That's what I'm saying. The divorced family.
But Jim, I think what you're kind of missing is there is a large group of the older people that do not choose to live at a 55 and older, but want that style of living, and may have younger single people in the neighborhood. They do not want to be around people all their age and older. And that's what this product, it allows.
But it doesn't, because you're still gonna have families moving into it,
you need to go look at the product.
But you're gonna deter your 55 and up because they don't want to be around little kids.
This product is not conducive to small
children. The bottom line is we don't want that many houses per acre. I don't care what age you sell them at.
The issue is the precedent.
Whether this thing is zoned Res 1 or Res 6, if it's Res 1, I'm not interested in it. And then it'll stay in it.
And that's fine.
I'm not interested in it. And then what's going to happen is the guy's got to sell the property. He's got to invest himself out. He's got to go. There's a group of pilots who's going to want to buy this airport and they want to reconvert it back to public property.
That's fine too.
That's fine with me.
How many people?
That's you. You're going first. But then, last time we had a crash and an airplane literally hit my house in Laurel Springs.
Hey, it hit my driveway three times. I can get by with it.
Well, you know what? The next time when it hits somebody, it kills somebody, drive and hits a pedestrian, you know, how long have you lived in this?
18 years.
Exactly. The county's changed drastically in 18 years, and it's time for change now. This county's moving forward, and what we got to do is.
I just say, the issue is that you may be trying to do everything to make us happy, but if it's zone residential six, it's a precedent, and another developer can come along and not be as.
We're asking for it to be residential.
Even four. I mean, I fought residential on Nichols Road.
People get so hung up on that, and you may say.
And then they always ask for variances.
But,
you know, you have a certain designation, and then they ask for variances.
There's not necessarily four units to the acre. We're asking for 3.06. You could have,
in fact, there's one out of Nichols Drive I'm working on. It's a equivalent of a res six, but it's got 2.5 units to the acre. So what you really need to focus on is density.
Right.
And looking at the area, cottages at Greystone are coming in at 4 units to the acre. You got Addington at 4.54 units to the acre. You got Hunter's Run on the same highway. Please let me finish. I'll let y'all speak. Let me talk. You got Hunter's Run that's coming in at 3.87 units to the acre. So you're concerned about precedent. This is actually much lower. This is going to set a lower precedent. But
Ethan, you're not being honest. You're picking out those few subdivisions, mm-hmm. the majority, 98% or 97% is 1+ acres. Our neighborhood is 1+ acres. We're on the other side of Dennis, who has 16 acres.
A lot of those are still zoned agriculture.
That whole property is surrounded by estate lots.
You're right. Some of those are, a lot of them are still
you're
zoned
agriculture. You're picking out the ones down the street.
Well, what we know is that an agricultural zoning is not a constitutional zoning in Forsyth County. We've had courts tell us that. So what we're trying to do is say, we can debate on what a constitutional zoning is, but it's something besides A1. So that's what we're here to talk with y'all about and say, okay, what's that something going to be?
And again, the county has set a guideline.
Did I hear correctly the starting price is 270?
No, I don't see how we can be less than that.
So okay. You're looking at basically.
We might be 269 now, but I don't see how. I mean,
okay.
Knowing our cost of our finished lot is going to take mine. This is not a forest site where I get to log the timber and sell the timber and make money and then go over here. This is an airport. I got to go grind like all this asphalt. There's an enormous amount of bad dirt just pushed off to the side on the way back in the day. That's got to get dealt with. You got to dig it back up, got to repack it down. So, this site's got an enormous amount of issues that come with it other than your stereotypical.
The other question is, do you know what it takes in order to, the planning department staff is not supportive at this point. Do you know what it takes to change it to supportive?
I haven't asked that question.
So you don't know why it's non-supportive?
If I had to guess, it's because I'm not 2.5 units to the acre. And my point being, if I'm 2.5 units to the acre, I'm actually putting down more bedrooms. So if I were to change it 2.5 units to the acre, let's just say I would be 2.5 units to the acre, and I was going to build exactly where Jacobi's building next door. These 5 bedroom houses, they would improve it. But in reality, that's going to greatly impact the schools. You know, add more traffic. You don't know that.
So you're basically looking at making about $18 million total from this with the amount of homes, what you're saying for the price point.
It's not meaning the Bahamas if I do that.
So, well, no, I'm talking about total sales.
Total revenue. Mm-hmm. I haven't done the math. That might be it.
Oh, okay. So if you do 30, 35 homes based at between $450 and $550, you'd be at the same price point or same total revenue. If you did 30 to 35 homes and make it, I think, a little bit more appealing to all of us, in that $450 to $475 and up price point, you would be at the exact same total revenue.
But you got
that's
interest
carry. That's not what
you
built.
I'm sorry.
You got interest carry. We've seen some market studies that come out in the holding period for these houses. You asked why they're all $250 or $350 there. The market demand for that is about 2.5 months supply. We start going up, we start getting into years supply.
So you think there's a 2.5
No, what I'm saying is the houses that you're asking for, 400,000 to 600,000, you're gonna have to hold them for 7, 8, 12 months before you can sell them.
Go look at Greystone, those big dollar homes for something.
And in our neighborhood, we had a second house on the right.
Y'all can argue anecdotes. All I can tell you is the market data.
Well, Well, all you're telling me is more.
This lady had a question.
Well, I just wanted to, you know, you mentioned when we talk about the size of the homes and the lot sizes, and you mentioned Abington is, would be kind of a similar, that's a surrounding neighborhood. But I think you're pointing to that particular neighborhood, but there are other neighborhoods that are more directly impacted by this neighborhood, and that is Laurel Springs, Lakeside Farms, Luberon, Gates at Luberon. All of those neighborhoods are bigger lots and bigger homes than what is proposed here. And you're just speaking about Abington would be the closest to this, and that's why this should fit in.
I think the super said that.
You're right. You have Laurel Springs, you have the other subdivision, the Greystone subdivision, you have Lakeside Farms, you have the larger lot, the bigger house. Have those communities. We also have an enormous amount of resales in those communities. And I just don't believe that I can build a house that's comparable to something that's in Wall Springs or that's in Grayston that can compete head to head.
Well, now one thing that you mentioned is you're doing ranch houses. Ranch houses. And that's good because there's high demand for ranch houses, larger ranch houses. And I think you could succeed very nicely with a 400,000 ranch house on a larger lot. So those houses are in high demand in rare areas that they exist in the county.
Folks, I have got it in my notes that y'all want more expensive houses and you want less of them. So, do y'all have any other questions?
Yes, sir. If I start larger ranch houses, I'm going to start introducing more families. You're now asking to do something more conducive to family buyer.
Well, instead of 66, how about 25?
I think that makes much more sense. I've already cut it 40%. I'm at my breaking point. This is it. I'm at my breaking point. I can't go anywhere. We can zone whatever he wants to zone. My contract is contingent on my zoning getting successful as I want. I don't want to back out. Another group's going to come in and have this experience.
Yes.
Has the planning commission scheduled a hearing on this
that happens coming up on the 30th of December.
30th of December.
Isn't that the magic day?
That's a great
day.
Trust me, I'm not excited about it either. I was supposed to be on vacation. So.
I'm here to work with you. I don't believe it's a $400,000 to $600,000.
Town Acres are the same thing at Edward Anderson.
Okay, I don't believe this community. If this was the only one coming in, if this was one of three deals coming in, or one of three new subdivisions, you'd be right. You'd be dead on. I'd have no competition. You're right, but it's not the case. What I'm trying to do is try to do something different than everybody else. Kind of offer a product that does not, that mitigates traffic, can mitigate schools, reduces the impact of Laurel Springs, reduces the impact of myself. I live here. You know, I can't say anymore. You know, it's tough being in this business. It's difficult. In my own company, we need this deal. We need some. I'm willing to give up. I'll have zero rentals in this community perpetually. I'll put that in the covenants.
What about zero on-street parking?
You can't regulate that because it's a county thing. You can restrict
it. Put it in your covenants. It's another covenants in other neighborhoods.
It's public roads. I'm gonna have public roads.
That's not private. I mean, the covenants
This is gonna be a public road.
That was private.
Right. Our streets and our subdivision are public roads. That goes under county laws. But what I did do to mitigate that was I provided an enormous amount of additional overflow parking throughout the community. And we have three areas of overflow, actually four. We have overflow parking here. We have a little bit here, but we have a good bit of overflow parking here, overflow parking here, and overflow parking in the community. So I've done that. I've taken that into account. That was a concern that was already brought up to me. And so we did that. We also broke up the way that this subdivision looks. We've incorporated some more landscaping in between units. And Mr. Big, I'll gladly work with you anyway.
I could care less than somebody walking out of their front door sees across the street.
I mean, I don't see walking anywhere.
Because, like I said, that's sitting way up on a hill. I mean, people see them.
I agree. So, I'll fence it.
Four sided brick?
Well, would you rather look at trees or brick?
I don't want both. I mean, you know. Could you talk about it so short? Because since it's a ranch, you don't have that much space in the back. I mean, what's going ahead and tack it on four-sided brick? You know, 40 foot apart.
You know, look, you're going to sell this out before you build the first house. And you know, you will. Because this is the lowest price point.
It's four-sided brick that they'll make
it for you. Completely surrounded by streams.
Four-sided brick that they'll make it for you.
Open pastures.
Hey, I looked at it this way.
Four-sided brick that they'll make it for you.
Nope. Don't pay more than that. I tell you what, you know, you put it up. If I don't like it, I'll put the chicken coop right behind it.
So you
mean to be calling the county on you nonstop?
You made a statement earlier that you're not aware of what the planning commission's objections are to the application.
No, I didn't say that. What was asked was, do I know what it would take to make them be supportive of it?
Planning staff.
I mean, they told me the objection was that they thought it was too dense.
Too dense, okay.
Yeah. But you know, if you look at it holistically, it gets
well, and I think that must be accurate because that's what you're hearing from this whole community. Right. It should be one house an acre. It's surrounded by the state lot homes up to 16 acres statewide.
I'm not building that. I won't do it. I will bow out. If you get zoned Res 1, that's fine. I won't build it. It'll stay in airport. The airport will become, we'll get reverted back to public-private designation, and you'll have 100 airplanes that will be harbored out there. Most importantly, you have airplane traffic that can now stop in and fuel up and go, and they use it as a refuel.
You know, we need to check on that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that runway is just
maybe
we need to check on that.
Airplanes fly in.
Yeah, of course they do.
Thank you,
Stuart. Do you have a question? Shut it down.
Just
got
to bring
home any contract, y'all, and shut down. It's another
matter. All right, any other questions?
Yes, sir. I wanted to ask you at the pool, are you going to have trees or anything in there?
Yes, sir.
What kind of trees?
What kind of what?
I guess little cypress if they're close enough together, but that's where I've been living. And I don't want to look across my drive and I can see their hair coming out of a swimming pool. Yeah.
But again, because it's a big lot.
That's right. Stay home.
It's a stay home.
I'm in the state lot, and you're going to look at a swimming pool.
Seriously. I'm not gay. I'm a born-again Christian, and I don't care for all that.
Sir, what we usually do with people ask for plants is try to, well, we can work with you. But if you put in one plant, if you get a fungus, it'll wipe out everything. So it's better to try to get the mixtures.
And I'll be honest, if the houses all the way around there was, you know, two homes per acre, then this right here really and truly wouldn't be that big of a deal.
Right.
If we were even R1 all the way around, well, this would still be a big deal. But we're talking, we're a state homes. I mean, we're like multiple acres. And no, I can't split my, you know, if I had a lot that I could split up like that, it probably wouldn't affect me as bad. But I can't. I've got to keep a state homes around me to keep my value up. So
one thing to keep you know, we include a big buffer along the side.
You know, 50 foot is not a big buffer. I mean, I had to go through the fence and put a pool 25 feet from my property line. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, it's 50 foot, because that's what you're talking about. Well, some of these houses are actually closer to the property line than 50, aren't they?
No, 50 foot's a fair minimum. We're actually much further on a lot of areas. And especially in this area, perfect. That's 50, 20, 7, 75 feet.
Okay, that's less than the width of this room right here.
You've got a substantial buffer between them. But then you got to look at if you've done that way, you would have.
I mean, I just think
they can figure all the way down the line.
Right, I like the buffer I got now.
I'd like to make it better. But let me,
all right,
guys, I'm trying to work with you. I've decreased my density 40%. I've reworked my site plan. I've drastically changed my product. I'll cut out all the rumors. I'll have HOA maintaining everything. I mean, 9 out of 10 ain't that bad.
And you'll give us trees around the pool?
We'll get the trees around the pool.
Bills out there?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'll do it.
So that, is that the acre one? Is that your latest one right there?
This is our latest plan. We've not sent it to the county yet.
And now, here again, your density and all that, you're basing that on the square footage of this big green area right here. So the houses are actually built closer than our 3.5. Even though you're saying 3.5 homes per acre, you got to knock off, what is this little green area down here, about an acre and a half?
And all the green.
Is that about right?
It's the total acreage.
Right, but that's what I'm asking. This little green area right here.
Argument, sir.
No, I know, this little green area right here, how big is that?
This right here.
That you're saying is for everyone to grow on?
This is about 2 acres.
It's about 2 acres. So, I mean, you take the 2 acres out of the overall mix. The density now is probably, do what?
Why would we take the 2 acres?
Yeah, the density is 5 acres.
Right. Right. Well, that's what I'm looking at. I'm looking at the...
If we did the same thing at Laurel Springs, you'd be aghast at the density.
Oh, if we took out the golf course.
Yeah, but the golf course is buffered. You put a golf course behind these, I'm signing up tomorrow. So you put a golf course around this, I'll sign it tomorrow. I got no problem with it. But here again, you're mixing apples and oranges there. I mean,
no, I'm just you're saying don't count this land, don't count this land.
Well, I mean,
that's not fair. Fortunately, Forsyth County recognizes that if they're going to tell people they can't use the property, and you have to reserve green space, then at least get counted for price.
At the end of the day, what is most important? Is it impact on schools, traffic, or size of housing?
Size of lot is the biggest thing at the end of the day. If you can sell them for if you can put that same size house on two different things and sell it for $450,000, which you probably can't do, I'm happy with that. It's size of lots, how close the houses are to that.
You have to finance it.
No, then you walk away from it. And I'm good. I mean, that's...
It doesn't work.
Then it doesn't work. So throw the towel in.
Do y'all have any other questions? Thank you all for coming out. We appreciate it.
Please sign the sign-in sheet if you have not done so.
You have it. I've got it.
Did that when Scotty built the subdivision rezoned. That's when
you own to the center of the road. Jerry's property owns to the center of the road. The Powell's own to the center of the road. And Mr. Freeman is to the center of the road.
Eminent domain.
They just take it. No, because he has a rezoned. They have to rezone.
I didn't bring back the one I found in my basement.
So we're pretty on plan. We usually have a little bit of an Asian
So you're just here? Oh, okay.
I've never walked back.
That was the attorney. If they just would have built a pool, they could have easily paid for it.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
So, you just sign it.
Well, nice chat with you.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. Good night.
Yes, all Alabama.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for coming. I appreciate it.
Not a problem.
If you don't mind, sometimes I come meet with you. Maybe I can show you our houses.
Maybe you come by. I'm in my office right now.